Derek, you there? All right. Hey, everybody. We are Fisher's Arts Council, and we are live here on YouTube with Derek Tudor, and we're also on our website as well. We're welcoming Derek back for the second Saturday. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for having me.
And I am excited to have you share your metalwork today, and you've got like a rainbow design today.
Yes. Well, like I said, I'm Derek Tudor.
Derek. Yes. So I am going to mute myself, and I'm going to let you, Derek, take control of the show here. And I hope you guys really enjoy this. And don't forget, you know, if you're on our website, to click Derek's name so you can join and start talking directly with him. So take it away, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Welcome, everybody. This is Derek Tudor. I am a multi-interdisciplinary artist. I do a lot. I wear a lot of hats. That's what that stands for, multi-interdisciplinary artist. Right today, I'm going to get into one of my skills that I have that I love almost out of all the art forms that I do, such as like painting. I do little sculptures. As you see, I do a lot of different steel artwork also. So that's my heart. That's where my heart's at, doing this steel artwork. And this is you're right sitting in the heart of my real steel art gallery right now. And I just want to let you guys know that we're going to have some fun today. We're going to do a piece that I call a rainbow ladle, okay? You might be like, oh, he's putting words together. Yes, I am. Just imagine if a tornado and a rainbow had a baby. That's what you're going to see. That's what you're going to see today, okay? A rainbow ladle. That's what I'm about to produce today for you guys. And it's going to be pretty fun. It's going to be a little loud sometimes, but the tools I use are these air tools right here. And like I say, this right here is a DA or a sander. This right here is one of the tools that I'm going to use only just maybe once or twice. This kind of quiet. That's kind of quiet. It rotates pretty fast going around. And I got a pad on there that's kind of rough. It's like the grade is maybe an 80 grade. This right here is the loud boy right here. This is my paintbrush for artists. You know what I'm saying? You artists out there, if you got your paint, this is my paintbrush today. It's an angle die grinder. Angle air die grinder. And it goes. And I can adjust it. The more I hit the trigger, the faster it goes. So I'm going to be hitting this. And I'm going to let you know when I'm about to hit it. That was a test. But when I hit it, just, you know, turn your volume down if you want to, if it's too loud for you. Okay? So today's rainbow ladle is going to go really kind of fast for the grinding and all the tools. Then I'm gonna get into the painting. Hopefully I'll get most of the painting done today. Should be done today, for sure. Now, the last Saturday, you guys that didn't tune in, we did a Winter Wonderland, and we ran out a little time before I get our paint done. So I just want to let you guys see what it turned out to be. Almost, it's not totally done, but this is what I did last week. It is a Winter Wonderland. That's how this looks with color on it. You know, I'm getting it over here so you guys can see the way the shine just shimmers and things. So that's what the guys saw last week. So if any of you guys was here last week, this is almost done. So this just lets you see how some of these things turn out. You know, some like things behind me, all right? So we're about to get busy, y'all. We're about to get busy. But now, Brad, for today's piece, the rainbow ladle, I'm gonna start out with grinder, just right here, and the pad on here is a really rough one. So this is like a 50 grade, and the higher the number, the softer the grade. So in other words, if you're gonna sand some wood or something, you're gonna use like 120, because you don't wanna take the wood down. This right here, eat the wood up. You know what I'm saying? It'll grind it away. So this is a 50, so this is really rough. This is what I'm putting the outline of the rainbow ladle. Then I'm gonna switch it to a 120, which is the real soft one I told you about. So when I get to the 120 in a few seconds, I'm going to fill in the rainbow ladle, and then I'm gonna come back to the 50 grade to go back over my outline. I'm gonna throw down with the sander there, put some bottom ground on there. It's going to be representing the ground. So without further ado, I'm ready to go, you guys. Y'all ready? So, all right, one more thing. While I'm about to do this here work, while you're watching me work, I'm going to have your mind working, okay? So I got my producer behind the camera there. She's going to ask a trivia question to you guys. Yeah, you didn't know that, did you? It's going to be interactive, okay? So she's going to pick out one of them that, you know, I picked out. I thought they might be kind of fun for all ages. And some of the questions are going to be pretty interesting for all ages, too. I was astounded with some of those questions I found and found out the answers about. So, you ready, guys? Here we go. Before we start, I'm going to get y'all to thinking. Give them a question, producer.
Okay. What web retailer started in 1994 as an online bookstore?
An online bookstore, y'all. One more time, and then I'm about to go.
What web retailer started in 1994 as an online bookstore?
All right, don't be Googling, okay, y'all? Let's use your mind. Here we go. Right now, I guess put your answers in the comment. So look here. This is the first part of the outline, you guys, of the rainbow natal. Okay? That's just the outline. Freehand in it, coming off the top of the head, you guys. This is freehand, just going off of some crazy imagination that I have. Going to the grinder now. Watch this here. Nice and quiet. Y'all put your answers in there, you guys. I want to see who can guess that one. And you guys are going to be totally surprised at the answer. And I'm going to give y'all a hint. All right. I think you're almost done with this part. All right. All right. All right. All right. Got it. Done with that one. All right. So now I'm going to put a couple of more little lines in here. Now that is my outline. And you go this down here, it's going to be the ground in a second. Man, this is about to be one of the beautifulest things you ever seen in your life. So now I'm about to switch out this to the light 120 gray, go inside these lines. This is about to put the bling on top of this once I put that color in. I'm gonna check the time. You look good on time, so here we go. Any takers on the answer? What would they say?
Amazon.
Yes. Who? All right. So listen. Type your name in there. First name and your last initial. That's good. Let everybody know who's the brains up in this piece, okay? So, I'm about to do this. It's going to take me a second. Give him another question. Give him one more question real quick before I get started, because it's going to give me a second. I'm going to get out of this here. Yes. Give him the question. Let's go. One more question, you guys. Let's see what we got.
Okay. Next question. Who played the Crown Prince of Zamunda in the comedy Coming to America?
All right. Who played the Crown Prince in...
Of Zamunda. In the comedy Coming to America.
Comedy Coming to America. Y'all got that one. Here we go. See how the light reflects off the diamond cuts in there? It's almost, I can put it in a category of like a diamond. When you get put one of those eyepieces on there, them jewelers, see that diamond, all those facets inside the diamond? That's what this reminds me of. And, I haven't seen a lot of diamonds, but seen pictures of them. So now, this will be the final time with these grinders air tools. If we are looking great on time, we're going to get in there and get some painting done in here. With some transparent paint. The transparent paint is paint that is going to be able to let that shine and shimmer come through instead of like a regular acrylic oil paint or something. It'll cover it straight up. You won't even be able to see the steel up under it. So this is going to be super, super cool. I mean, really super cool. To get answers on that, all right, I'm going to tell you the answer. What is it? Who is it?
Eddie Murphy,
yes. And they got part two to that. It was pretty funny. One more question, y'all. Get one more question so I can get back in here so we can get this done. And then we're going to be moving on. Give us another good question.
Okay. Another question.
All right, y'all.
What e-commerce site was founded in 1995 by Pierre? I'm not sure if I'm saying last name right. Amadior.
All right, that's close enough. Who started that e-commerce store? And I'm gonna give you guys a hint. A lot of us didn't shop there before. Okay, so go ahead, y'all. See who can get that. Here we go. Last part of this year.
eBay.
It is. Yes, it is. One more, real quick. One more. You know, since y'all getting good over there, y'all getting good. Let me go ahead and let me get you one more.
Okay.
Here we go.
All right. Let's see.
She's picking through them, y'all.
Okay. Yeah. IBM launched what groundbreaking product in 1981?
Oh, yeah. Now, everybody use these today. All right, you guys, we are looking good here. Let me go. Oh, yeah, we are doing it, you guys. We are doing it. Let me wipe out all this here metal. This is look like sand on top of here, but it's not. It's actually stainless steel shaker. But it's okay. We got everything protected in the headquarters here. Now, we are ready to throw down. Now the cooks come to the fun part, guys. Painting. I can get rid of the protective gear here. Now, you can get some of this paint in here, bring it in. And once I throw down with this paint, man, this is going to turn this thing totally out. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to start up to at the top part and work my way down. So that way, if I work my way started from the bottom up, I put my hand here, I might put my hand inside something that hasn't dried, spirited, mess it up. Nah, you don't want to see that. None of us want to see that. So, yeah, so we are about ready. I'm going to just touch up one little spot. Oh, we're going cordless, guys. We're going cordless, you know, because I'm going to get quieter now. This is just to put me in a little brown side, a little effects on this brown part down here. So it just makes the texture totally different from the rest of the tool. Now, you probably can't tell a lot, but you know, you will see it once I put the paint on. It's going to make that paint stick to that steel even more. Even more. And it's so quiet. I love these. Love it. All right, guys. Did they get the last question?
Personal computer.
Told you everybody gets, everybody knows that, you know, but here we go. That's awesome. While I get this paint together, go ahead and give them another one. Give them one more. I'm gonna go ahead and set up a lot of paint because it's gonna be going down here today, y'all. Going down.
Okay.
Go ahead, hit them up.
All right. What was the name of the bar where everyone knows your name?
Your name. Everybody knows your name. Yeah, that's going to be easy.
So do you have a particular brand of transparent paint that you prefer?
No, I don't. I like trying different ones because I haven't found that one that just made me fall in love with it just yet. Good question. Because I be wondering sometimes myself when I'm ordering it, I'm like, well, what should I do this time? You know, so it is hard sometimes to find some good transparent paint because you know, it's not easily accessed here in Indianapolis anyway. You can go to some hobby stores and they might not have them. Tattoo parlors might have them sometimes. But you can find them where you can find airbrush equipment. And airbrush. That's my best place to start. But I'm most of the time online. I'll go online and you know, and that's where I have to go and get it. So good question. Nice. Let me see if we'll make some dabble with some different colors and make up some colors. So let me see. So now let me see. Where is my sponge? That is one thing here. Get my paint. Put this here. All right. So water it down just a bump. Some of this clean water. I'm just squeeze a little dab in there. Oh, that water was so clean. Okay. So I have some paint. There we go. Got it. All right, then. So I got a syringe with some water in it. I'm going to put a little dab of water in these. Just make them a little bit more transparent. So I'm doing that. A little bit of this more water. And all right. Anybody got a particular color you want me to start out with? Any color? Anybody? Let's see what we got. Anybody want to come up with?
Green.
Green it is. Some people got some pretty fast fingers out there. It would have took me a second or two to even get that in there. Yes, we're going with green. We're going with green first. All right, going green up at the top. We're going in the green, the big one, the big piece right here with the green right quick. All right. Yeah, Yes, I have to go with the long strokes because one, if you try to get it in one stroke, that's best. So you don't have no extra lines in there once it dry. But it's got, I got a secret weapon to make this really look good when I'm done. And that is the sealer, which is the spray paint that is a clear coat. And man, wait till you see that. Right now you won't see shine yet coming through until I hit it with the paint. It's just the spray paint, the sealer. It is going to be like almost like magical, man. Once that hits that spray paint hit it, man, it's just going to turn it into a whole dimension. Okay, so let me see. I'll let this down there a little bit. Got me some hair. Got some of my hairs from the brush in there, which is also cool. Not a problem. I'm going to go my way down to the base of the... Yes, I believe you guys probably are seeing where my vision is now with all about the rainbow nail now. Okay, so now right there, I'm going to let that... You can see the little bit of shine coming through. And what I like to do, too, is take off just a little bit. Just a little bit. Just so it'll bring my steel coming through a little bit. So, yes, we kind of waste a little bit of it, but it's all worth it. It's all worth it. Anybody got a guess for the next color? We're going to be interactive with this one. I'm going to rad out with you guys today. Rad. Anybody want a color that they want me to do? I can pretty much make any color. I got a beautiful purple that I will create with the red and blue.
Red.
Red it is. I was looking at that red myself, and I was like, ooh, I love going with that red right beside that. Let's see. Keep going up top. We're going to stay with the big ones.
Holiday colors.
You sure? Yes, here we go with the red. Now, I'm going to touch the other green just a little bit, just so we can cover up any steel. And I'm going with the little strokes right now. Once I get it out, the paint all saturated through the middle of the rainbow nail. I love that name, man, the rainbow nail. It was funny, though, when I made it up. Kind of funny. Uh-oh, got a little out of the way. That's one thing about it. Mess up, you can wipe it straight off. Or if it don't come out, you just put water on it and it'll come straight out. But this paint is water-based. But rainbow nail, you guys, almost had another name. And this one, it is all right, but it just didn't have that same flavor as the rainbow nail. It was going to be the tornado. A tornado. You know what I'm saying? I was like, that don't sound as good as what I got. So we're going to stick with this.
Good question. How do you keep the... Let me go back to the question. Oh, how do you keep the lines between the colors so tight? Is the green paint already dry?
Yes. Yes, it is. It is... It dries real fast. Plus, as you noticed, once I get it all saturated in there and get the long strokes like this, what I do is I hit it, let it dry just a couple of seconds, and then I will hit it with the towel and take off some of a little lightweight of the coat off of it. So once I take a little coat off of it, it will dry even faster. It dry even faster. Plus I have the some heat on in here to help it dry too. So that's helping everybody. All right. So.
Does it matter what type of brush you use?
Yes, it really do, because I got some detail brushes and then I have some fat brushes that will just cover a lot of area, a lot of ground right now. Because like right now, what I'm doing is touching up some stuff right here where I messed up. Yeah, I messed up. Them happy mistakes is what a Bob Ross calls. Yeah, happy mistakes. So, but the brushes, I have them up here so I can grab them as I need them. Because once you, you're on the time limit, you want to just go faster as you can. And you don't want to have to be scrounging through your paintbrushes, you know what I mean? So I do have some trim brushes that are called cut brushes, or they got a nice little edge on them. Sometimes they got a nice little edge on them. And then the trim, we got some detail brushes with, like this one here is one of my favorites right there. It's like a rat tail brush. And this one right here will be one of the ones also that if I was painting a painting at the end, this is one I would use to do my signature. You know, believe it or not, it just, like, it swirls it really cool when you're doing your cursive writing. It's really easy to call it. But anyway, we're going into another color. So, anybody want to give me another color? Give me another color. Come on through. What color y'all want to go in here next with this rainbow NATO? Y'all can see it now coming together, can't you? Y'all can see it now. Look at that. That light. And what you see once I put this, when I put that clear coat on it, the clear coat cuts through the paint that is dry, and then it'll absorb and it'll go through the paint and it attaches to the stainless steel. It is amazing. Blew my mind when I first done it. And then it is gonna bring the shine through the colors. It's great. You're gonna see in a second. You're gonna see.
Blue.
Blue it is. Yes. So we're going with the blue. We're going with the blue over here. I'm gonna go with this blue over here. Yeah. Let me see. Let me get this the bigger. So I'm gonna get a big brush. All right. So while I'm doing this blue in here, got another quick got one more question for them. Give them one more trivia. They've been doing pretty good. I'm trying to see who's the brains. See if they beautiful and beauty and brains. You know what I mean? There are my beautiful people out there.
Okay. 1-800-CRIME-TV was the tip line for what show? 1-800-CRIME-TV was the tip line for what show?
Oh, I kind of remember that a little bit. Let me think. Okay, I think I know where it is. So let's see who got the answer. Yeah.
Yeah.
They got it?
Yeah, America's Most Wanted.
There it is. Everybody want to be a star. They say, I want to be on TV, but not that show. No. Every show but that one. That blue, y'all, was a good choice. Really knocked it out of the park. That blue is so nice. I'm going to go over that middle. See now, that outline is a different texture than the middle part that I put in here. And so that is going to act as a border for the tornado, rainbow tornado. Yeah. So, and also you guys, you can definitely check out some more of my artwork, this steel work that I have out there. Man, I have some awesome work. I have a piece right now that is on exhibit at this work gallery in Indianapolis called the Harrison Center. Yeah, it was there. And I have a whole collection of real steel art gallery artwork. And I love to come on up there to Fisher's with it all. Bring a whole kit up there. Let you guys see a whole collection live. It is amazing to see this art, the steel artwork live and in person. Because as you move to the side, it's like almost moves. It is crazy. Like I say, you could just tell a little bit how it just moves now, you know, in the light. Man, but live, it is amazing. You know, it's amazing. Makes you want to touch it. And, you know, so most of the time, my sculptures is, you know, do not touch on those. But some of these other ones that are like this, you can't touch. I'm going to swing it around here, you guys. Go around into the red. On this red side, because red is dry pretty well, but it's got a little couple spots. What you think about yellow, guys? Right in here. Let's go with the yellow. We're going to brighten it up. The yellow is something else, you guys. I'm going to tell you. Wait till you see how the yellow jumps in here. Yellow just It does its own thing. I love it. So here we go with this yellow. Yeah, this yellow, man, is just, I don't understand how or why, but the yellow is just such a dominant color when you put it on this steel, you know? It's because it's bright, probably, but it is awesome when it's coming off on this stainless steel, you guys. Wait till you see this boy here when it dries. I'm going to get the first coat on there. Then I get the long stroke in it like this so we can get rid of those little lines. Yeah. And if you can't hear the music, that is some original music that me and one of my producers made. We made these tracks for this online show I had. When the pandemic hit, I was doing a show around Indianapolis, all over the city, called the 2020 Vision Art, Music, and Fashion Show. And it got pretty big. And then we got hit with this here pandemic. COVID-19 hit, shut down the art galleries, shut down all the businesses, and I could not do my 2020 Vision Art, Music, and Fashion Show anymore because of the pandemic. So I took it online. Yes, I did. I changed the name to the 2020 Vision Art, Music, and Fashion Online Show. So we were doing it online, and we had a great time. And I had artists coming in there from home, coming into the show, just like I'm doing right now with you guys. And they were doing their art. We had models. We had singers, poets. And you can see some of these live shows that was taped still. But we had this music in the background and an intro to the show and everything, man. So yeah, this is the music. It's a personal music. So I do own the rights to this music. So we won't get a cut off. You know, they're like, oh, I don't have the rights to play that. Yes, we do, folks. But if you want to see one of those shows, you can go to Derek Tudor on Instagram. Just how my name is spelled there on mine. You can go there and check it out. Got it. Go over this right here real quick. Throw this in here. This is fan brush.
What does the fan brush do?
It is a cleanup brush today. Because, I mean, once I do a see something that didn't dry right, I'll go over it with the fan brush to bring it the colors in. So once it dry, go back over it again, and it'll make the color blend in real good. That's what a fan brush is used for today in the stainless steel arena. But it's used for a totally different reason when you're doing paintings on canvas, though. It's totally different. So I'm going to stick with this yellow, and I'm going to start, since I got this yellow going pretty good, I'm going to hit me about 2-3 spots with the yellow. That's how I'm going to do this, you guys. So now it's time to get this thing popping. Because watch this. Now it's about to move at a high rate of speed. I'm going to put some yellow right here. If you got another trivia, go ahead. I don't think we have any more, but we might. Yeah, because y'all can watch me work now, y'all. Y'all about to watch me work. Okay, so I got the yellow in there. I'm going to lighten it up. It's really heavy.
Okay. In what film does Adam Sandler become a golf pro?
Adam Sandler becomes a golf pro?
Mm-hmm.
Adam Sandler.
And Adam Sandler. In what film does Adam Sandler become a golf pro?
Come on, y'all. I know y'all know that. I don't know. I'm going to tell you the truth. Because I got an idea, but I think I'm on the wrong movie.
Okay. Here's a question. Is the paint water-based?
Yes, it is. Thank God. Because you can blend it and make it as light as you want. You see, I'm noticing that I have this syringe full of water, and I'll put water in there on top of it to thin it out so I can make it do what I want it to do, you know, because it can get on its own agenda sometimes. Because if it's not watered down, it will be thick and it won't work right. Good question. Good question. Come on with some more questions, y'all. Y'all get me trivia, you know, over here too.
All right. And here's an interesting comment. It seems like the paint might want to beat up on the metal rather than coat evenly. Do you find that to be the case?
Sometimes. Sometimes. It did beat up on me on my this other piece I did do, but you water it down a little bit more, it should cooperate. Okay. You know, it should cooperate a little bit more.
So putting more water helps it from beating up as much?
Yes. Yes, it do. That must be an artist. I like that. Come on, artist. Talk to me. Yeah. I love it. So let me go in with some. Oh, let me try this here. I have not put this purple in yet. Oh, it came out real nice. Yeah. Purple is really nice. And put this purple next to the yellow. Got a spot for this purple. Ooh, bold. Nice purple. Oh, man, I just got to get my home. So I got to be careful. There we go. Now, this purple is so dark and bold, I will get it with the towel, lighten him up a little bit. Just a little bit. Yeah, here we go. Now I'll put some of this purple on this other side real quick. Now take the tail, damp it.
Is this a difficult technique to learn? Like, do you have to have a lot of prior painting or metal experience?
Yes, you do have to have the metal and painting experience. And it pays to, like I say, to have them both, but it is not hard, because once you just learn the technique, like, well, I'll have a classes coming soon, and so the people that'll be doing it are artists already. You know, most of the time, you know, I don't train anyone that is have not had prior art skills or painting in some kind of form in the paint or artistic skills. But most of the time they're just painters of acrylic and oil. And that is all they need, really. And that'll help them immensely in learning this technique, you know? So I will try, and like I said, these classes will have to be like live, because you can't, because most people don't have just these tools sitting around at home. You know, if they did, it'd be great. We do it online, you know? So I would end up doing them live and letting everyone just come on in and just learn it, and then they can go home with a piece of art. Now, we'll be doing these at festivals and things, because I'll do nameplates like this, and I'll do them live at festivals and events. I'll rent a booth, and I'll come and do it. I'll have all these tools will be air tools. I won't have to have the big old air compressor, you know. So that's going to be great. That's going to be great. Yeah.
Getting supplies can be kind of pricey. Seems like it might be expensive for this. Is that correct?
Kind of. It is in a sense, because really, once you get your the tools, you know, you can go and get you a air compressor, then you know, you can go from there and then just pick up little tools, different places, or they're really not expensive. Like the angle die grinder. This little guy here is awesome and is essential. This is really cheap. This is under $20. You know, yeah, sander, you probably get that nowadays for, you know, a little of nothing, maybe $20-$30. You know, and right here local. Right here local. You don't even have to go online, you know. And they're not really expensive no more. I love it. I'm really loving it. Yeah, I love it a lot now that it's not expensive. Because when I first started, like I say, 3-4 years ago, they were a little high. Prices is going down because the air tools are going down, especially because there a lot of folks are going into the you know, cordless. So obviously they went on down with the price to compete.
And that's a good transition to this next question. Are the battery operated tools as effective as the air driven ones? And why not just go with batteries from the beginning?
Well, personally, I like the air for the just because they are more effective and a lot faster for me. But I do not say that they are best for everybody, you know, because now I'm getting into the air tools a lot more because I'm ready to, you know, do this mold. You know, I will do this now coming up in 2022. I will have this live at my Minivan Go Mobile Art Gallery. So when the Minivan Go Mobile Art Gallery is out here at an event, like say at a festival or a fair, you know, you can get you one of these pieces done live. You can say, hey, I want one of these for, say, happy birthday to my wife or happy birthday to my daughter. So I will get her name, write it down, then I say, you know, I have it on one of these plaques. You know, and then I can do these live. So that's the greatest thing about those power tools that are cordless. So they're winning. They're winning. But like I say, you know, everybody got their own preference. Me, I like the power tools when I'm mobile. But if I, you know, if I'm here in my headquarters, yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and do it like that. Let's put some red right here on the end. I think I like that. All right, guys, check us out. This is about to be a Rainbow NATO completion. A couple of more strokes and the clock is ticking. And I thank you guys for playing along with my trivia. I love trivia just like y'all. I was enjoying myself. You know? Wish we had more. I think we're done. Was that all of them?
I think it was.
I think it was. Because I didn't think we were going to get through to all of them. So that's why I didn't have a lot. All right, you guys. Here we go. Let's see what's next. It'll be going here with this color here. We are about to sign this one in a minute. Let me see. Almost forgot this color, orange. All right, let's throw this orange in here. What we got? We got us less than 15 minutes. Any more questions, please? Don't hold back. Come on with them. Let's throw this blue in there too. Yeah, there we go.
So how long is this going to take to set once you put the clear coat on top of it?
The clear coat would take, I will set it outdoors for maybe an hour. And don't really need that much time at all. The whole hour is really just so the fumes will get off of it before I take it indoors to my home. But clear coat is like instant dry. It dries almost instantly.
What do you use exactly for the clear coat? And do you have to do any treatment to the paint before you apply it?
No, I don't. I really do not. The clear coat is like almost instant dry, and because the paint here is going to be done with all this setting up, curing, and everything, This paint is about to be like ready to go. Yes, it is.
And you'll show the bottle when you're ready to use it, right?
The clear?
Yes.
Yes, I have it right here. It's a really basic one. It's a Rust-Oleum. I really keep it simple and just try to get the best quality. That there is a local, and most of you guys probably already viewed that before. It is one of my favorites. I use that also to finish up when I do branding. I do tabletop branding, which is companies that have tables outdoors, like picnic tables. I go and I will put their brand, their logos on the top of their picnic tables. And that'll be the first coat after I do the acrylic paint. I will put a coat of that on there, and then I will put the last coating, the final coat of sometimes the final coat, man, I might use resin, you know, just sort of just have that 3D pop. And you guys know how resin finishes. You know, resin is just beautiful. I love using resin. Now another thing, I could put resin over top of that on here too. Once I finish with this piece and that spray paint clear coating has dried, then I would go across with and put a coat of resin on top of this. So this one right here, I'm definitely going to put some resin on top of this one. This one is resin worthy, I'll say.
What will the resin do?
The resin will make it just come off of the steel. It will make it, make it about a quarter inch, almost a quarter of an inch thick. And it is amazing when you see it, you know. So that's one thing about that. Then we go with this brown. I told you guys this brown here is going to be the land.
Do you have any pieces that you plan on doing a little bit later?
Oh yeah. I've got a piece that I'm going to finish. That I've been working on for, believe it or not, over 3 years. Yeah, probably almost 3 years, rather, that I've been working on. You know, it's a piece that I really like, and it's a one that I've done most of the work with the air grinder, and then so now the only part left of that is all the detailing with the trim. And see, now when I'm done here, when this dries, before I put this coat on there, I'm going to just sign my name right here with the Dremel, Eric Tudor, and the date, which is the date. So let's see. I'm going to show you that piece too in a second. Yeah, matter of fact, get your opinion on it. Tell me what you think about it. Let's go with one more light reddish with some yellow. Yeah, lighten it up. Make it almost pink. That's what I'm missing, pink. Yeah, that's a nice color. Yeah, see, gotta have a steady hand. My hand wasn't always as steady. Oh yeah, there we go, you guys. I love it. That's a nice color. That is an awesome color. I just mixed that up together. I wanted some yellow and some red. And it's like more like a burnt orange. Really cool. So I'm about to show you guys this one piece, you know, and like I said, if you want to see some more of my work, you can go to Derek Tudor. You can see me doing lots of stuff, man. I mean, I do besides the tabletop branding, I do what is called live paintings in store shop windows. So I go down, I be in malls, and you might be walking down the mall, and you look in a window of any given store, and there I am sitting there with a piece taller than myself. It'd be pieces that be way over my head pieces. And I will be inside there painting.
So is that the largest piece you've done?
Pardon?
Is that the largest piece you've done?
No, no. Besides pieces, I do murals. So far as other than murals, yeah, that's probably the biggest out of those besides the murals.
What's the largest still piece that you've done?
Probably six. No. It was probably 7 by 7, I believe. 7 foot by 7 foot. Something like that. Yeah. And you can see one of them on the on Derek Tudor on Instagram. And like I say, another thing, my art is not only just for your hanging up. I have wearable art. You want to see something really cool. Yes, I have wearable art where you know what I've painted, you can put it on sweat. I've got them on sweatsuits. Yeah. Believe it or not, you can wear these clothes that have my art on. And they're amazing. They're amazing. Just amazing. I got a sweatsuit right now of one of my pieces. It's called the Sweet Backdrop. That piece is actually downtown in Indianapolis. They blew it up into a mural, and it is crazy. It's called Sweet Backdrop. But if y'all want to see some of those, go to So Trendy A2Z, the number two. So Trendy A2Z.com. And you're going to see my artwork on there, and it's going to blow you away, blowing you away. So check this out. Now, I'm not going to be able to sign it because my brown down at the bottom hasn't dried just yet, and my blue hasn't dried for me to put this coat on it. But while it's drying, I hope it'll dry so I can put the clear on there for you guys. This is the piece that, I've been working on for like 3 years. This right here. And this one is, I don't know if I'm going to call it, it's an angel. Might be Gabriel. But as you see, this here is super detailed. You know what I mean? And like I said, it's been taking me almost 3 years to do. And this has a lot of facets. It's got a lot of different textures to it. A lot of different textures. And this right here, I've got to put the texture. This is a snake, actual snake that's going to be here. With his head, I haven't finished the head, but the detailing is amazing. The detailing is amazing, you know? So this is the type of thing that I love doing that is taking me a while, takes a while. And like I said, in the nameplates, these are some of the nameplates, like I say, that I'll be doing live at events. So you just, also you can DM me and order these straight over, Instagram or at DerekTudor.com. You can order those also. So that's another thing you can do for Christmas. Bring gifts. So look here. I believe this is good enough for me to hold up. I think it's dry enough for me to hold up. Now, like I said, I might try to spray a little bit, just the top part, something, what a dry part, just so you can see the way the paint comes through it. You know, I'm gonna just do a little dab, just so you can see how that. This paint will just go through the spray paint right here. Goes through this color and it attaches to the steel and it brings the steel straight through it. It is amazing, you know. But I know we only got a couple of minutes left, you guys. So listen, thank you guys for hanging out with me again. You want to see more art? Like I said, go to DerekTudor.com or Derek Tudor on Instagram. Hey, it is awesome. But yeah, matter of fact, before I spray this, I will, don't even have to spray it. I will show you what it looks like. Get that over there, please. This is one after after it's got, this is what it's going to look like soon as the spray paint hit it. That's one coat of the spray paint on there. So,
Derek, this is gorgeous. Thank you so much for sharing this with us.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. I love being here with y'all. I really do. Man, this was fun. Super fun. Thanks for playing the game with me with the trivia, guys. You guys rock. You know, y'all rock. And awesome. When I'm back, I'm right here for you guys whenever y'all want me back.
I love that, Derek. Thank you so much. We've appreciated these last two Saturdays. These rainbow designs are killer. I love them. Thank you so much. All right, we're gonna learn how to work instead of with transparent paint, but with watercolor with Savannah. So thanks so much, Derek.
Thank you. Take over, Savannah.
All right. And so Savannah, we're gonna ask that you turn your video on, Savannah. All right, hey. So you participated with us last year, I remember, when we were virtual, and we're so excited to have you back.
We
get to see an awesome angle this year with the work that you're doing, and you're going to do watercolor for us.
Yep, sure am.
So if anyone is watching right now, we've been broadcasting this onto Facebook, we're on YouTube live stream, and we're on our website. You can go to our website, fishersartscouncil.org/winterwonderland, and click on Savannah's name to join the Zoom directly. All right, so Savannah, I'm going to let you take it away.
Okay, my name is Savannah Jacob. I am an illustrator and a potter. I currently work in a ceramic studio and I give private art lessons. And one of my favorite things right now is watercolor, and it has been for a few years. So I'm just kind of going to run through the basics of watercolor painting and also a little bit deeper dive too in how complex it can be and also your materials. So here I have Arches paper, and you will see a watermark in the corner. You might not be able to see this brightness, but if you had your own paper, you would see a watermark if it's somewhat of a high quality paper. And to make sure your paper is on the correct side, you're going to turn the watermark so that it's legible, and it should also be smooth on the side that is facing up, and the side that is facing down will have a bit of an indentation from where it's been stamped. So once you figure out which way your paper is going, that's step number one. And then if you need to tear your paper to make it a different size, watercolor paper typically comes in large sheets if you're buying quality paper. So you'll probably want to tear it down a little bit, but working large with watercolor is easiest and most efficient. Working smaller, it just becomes really hard to get a clean spread of the paint. Larger gives you more room to do that. So if you're going to tear down your paper, you never want to cut it with scissors. If it's quality paper, you want to fold it back and forth until it weakens and you can tear it. And that will give you an edge like this. And that is called a deckled edge. And that's just another way that people kind of know that you're working with quality material. So once you've torn down your paper, you've found the correct side. I then like to use a really light colored pencil. You can use a watercolor pencil or just a regular pencil, just draw really thin and faint lines. I drew mine a little bit darker just so that hopefully you guys can see the outline first. So that's the next step, is to do the outline. Then depending on if your painting is going to have large amounts of white space, you may want to use this, which is called liquid masking fluid. And it's kind of exactly like it sounds. It's like liquid masking tape. I think it's super fun to use. I have used it in my past few paintings, and it is so satisfying because you basically paint it on like you would if you're just using actual paint. And so in this little sketch I have, it's just kind of an abstract flower that I drew up. And there's some little like centers of what would be the petals, I guess, that I want to keep white. And so to protect the paper from the paint that I'm about to put over it, I'm first going to apply this liquid masking fluid. And so I just paint it onto the spots that I intend to be white. And eventually it dries. It dries quite fast, actually, in comparison to the watercolor paint. And this is just much easier than trying to outline each little shape that you want white. Since I'm making so many of these white, it's much more feasible to do this. This is also especially good if you have small white spaces that you're not going to want to make your brush carefully go around to avoid. That takes up time, and it usually causes parts of the paint to dry fast, which then the part you're outlining will not dry fast, and it could dry uneven, which is unfavorable for watercolor. Like, a true test of your skills would be like how evenly applied it is, or how even of a gradient it is. And you can clean the brush out from the liquid masking fluid just as you would a regular brush, which is just warm water and soap. I'm rinsing mine out right now, some of the water that I have. You also would like to have at least 2 to 3 cups of water to rinse your brushes out, depending on the color. So say I start first with a blue shade of color, I designate a water cup to darker shades and one to lighter shades, just so that you're not dipping a brush that you just painted yellow on into a blue water cup. So here's my green water cup that I've already been painting earlier. And so that's drying right now. The next thing that you'll do after applying the liquid masking tape, if you're going to have a flat background, you would choose your gradient of color that you're going to be applying. And always have, like, I keep this little journal, and it's a watercolor journal, and it has the exact kind of paper that I typically use, the Arches kind. It's made into a little book so that I can test out what colors I use. That way I can know what it's going to look like on this paper beforehand, because different papers do have different textures and different thicknesses, which can absorb differently than others would. And that's important when you're working with such a high water volume. So I just kind of brush that on, and I try to get usually some heavier and lighter, just so I have an idea. Also, if you're working with a consistent palette, you can make little match cards of the colors. It's a really quick, easier way knowing what the color looks like on what paper. Because I typically change my colors, and I've been letting them dry out and trying less and more water. So I haven't made a new booklet of matching sets yet. So for right now, this is what I've been doing and what you'll want to do if you're just starting out. So this is kind of a brown light color. You can see I applied it heavier there and lighter there. And I like that pretty well for the background, at least. The liquid masking tape will look almost the same dry as it does wet, which can be confusing, but you can gently just touch it and see if it's not dry all the way there. And it essentially just works as a resistant, like wax would. Watercolor as a painting technique, they will typically not want to leave like a border or an edge, just isn't the professional practice. I'm also an illustrator, and I always like leave a border and an edge. So when I started watercolor painting, I made a border like the first few times, and I was in college, and my professor was like, "Why are you doing that? That looks terrible." And I'm like, "I didn't know I wasn't supposed to." But if you want to be technical, that would be the technical way. If you're not too concerned with the technicalities, then do whatever you want. But just a heads up. All right. And if you're working fast, which we kind of are, as it's only an hour time frame. You might want like a hair dryer or a blow dryer or something to dry the layers quicker. I sometimes do that if I'm in a hurry with a painting, but it's just, it gets a more even spread of the paint if you let it air dry. And sometimes the air drying makes the paper move differently. And with blow drying, you might be like holding it flat to keep it steady and it wouldn't have the waviness of the paper. So it's kind of up to preference and also your intentions. Liquid masking tape looks pretty dry now. Some of them are a bit wet. Does anyone have any questions? I will now apply this color that I tested out as evenly as possible across the entire painting. For the first layer, which we're about to do, I typically like to use a fairly large brush. So this one is about average medium size, and that will do for general spaces, but for such a large covering, I want to use my biggest brush, which is this guy. Very soft. And I get quite a large amount dipped onto this brush. And if it's a larger brush, you'll be able to pack more paint into it. Then I'll start kind of at the bottom and evenly swipe upwards. And as the brush begins to run out, I'll just refill it over here. And the key to this part is to not let any of it dry at an uneven pace of the rest. So you do have to work a bit fast when painting larger areas in watercolor. Also kind of come back through and smooth it out. There may be a few uneven parts here, but it will be blended and come together more as a gradient if you apply it at the same wetness. Here's starting to turn. This is why you want to choose your largest brush. And this is very light, of course. Then you always want to clean out your brush each time. All right. And then you wait on it to dry. This was a fairly thin layer, so it should dry relatively quickly. While it's drying, does anyone have any questions? Let me see here. You mentioned a clear coat earlier. What exactly do you use? And do you, or is that from previously? How does the liquid masking tape come off? So yeah, you do just peel it. I'll show you that later, but you do just simply rub your finger over it and it comes off at the end. I am most interested in watercolor, but I've previously been pretty deep into acrylic painting as well. And I don't necessarily prefer watercolor over acrylic right now. I'm just doing more watercolor because I recently started it just a few years ago, and I've been doing acrylic my entire life, so I guess you could call it a phase. But as a practice, I'm still very interested in acrylic too. So yeah. they both have their benefits though. Acrylic is a little bit more forgiving and you can fix things much easier. Watercolor, not so much. If you put something down and it runs out of place, you might be able to add some water to kind of blend it out, but it wouldn't ever be fixed perfectly. And with acrylic, you can paint right over it. I've never worked with oil color though. As an illustrator, we would typically just work in acrylic and pencil sketching, you know. And so now I'm just going over this to kind of blend out some spots because it was dry enough. I'm adding just a bit more paint to blend it out. And this is very faint. It might even be hard to tell, but I'm adding more. And this is a kind of a warm brown tone. So it's also similarly colored to the paper already. All right, so now I've done that. And it's important to let this layer dry entirely, because if I went in with a second layer of the general areas and this layer wasn't entirely dry, they would bleed into each other, which sometimes can be favorable if that's the technique you're going for. But I, for this, am looking for crisp, readable lines, so I'm not going to allow the colors to bleed over each other, if possible. Sometimes it happens, but... This paper is relatively thin. I've worked with thicker paper to get more layers and satisfying, but very time consuming. Something I enjoy about watercolor and in contrast enjoy about acrylics is watercolor is very processed. Like it might take a while for each layer to dry and you're kind of, you know, waiting and pondering, and acrylic dries really fast, way faster than oil and watercolor together. So that is nice. I haven't used Zoom since about 2 years ago, so still refamiliarizing myself with it. And a lot of people like to do, are there some questions? So there are some colors and tones that are a bit more difficult to deal with getting an even tone if that's what you're going for. Typically darker colors are hardest to get even if you're covering a large amount of space. Working in smaller amounts of space is always easier to get even than if you were doing the entire thing like I just did. So whenever you do the flat layer in the back, that's part of why it's always, you always want it to be lighter, and then you'll make smaller spaces for darker things. So light to dark in watercolor. In acrylic, it would be dark to light typically. And I'm sure that's how it is with oil too, since they're similar, but yeah, so that one's harder. And does the medium make them read different? Yeah, the different types of paper can. There's, of course, larger variations than others, but for the most part, if you're buying similar weight in paper, then it will be a similar effect, but it's always good to test it out. And I think actually my book is paper that's a bit thicker than what I'm using currently, but they're close enough in weight that it looks just about the same. And this is starting to dry in areas. You can tell when it's dry just by looking at it. You'll be able to see that part's dry. I tend to touch white a lot, but once I get into the darker colors, I won't, because it'll leave more of a a print. And there's a few imperfections here where it's blood and it's not entirely even. I'm okay with that. I think that's kind of nice sometimes. That's another fun thing about watercolors is you can get weird like water marks and bleeds and things that you wouldn't necessarily be trying to get, but it can still add something to the piece without it being entirely intentional, which is kind of fun. So I'm gonna just finish cleaning up this larger brush and then choose my next one. I clean all my brushes with soap at the end. That's how you can make them last a long time. I've had this set since I started painting a few years ago, and it looks pretty much new to me. So I guess there's some gloss chipping off, but the brush itself is perfect. And yeah, as long as you take care of your brushes, they should last you a long time. They're kind of expensive starting out. It's a bit of an investment if you buy nice paints, nice paper, nice brushes and whatnot, but it's worth it. I also got this set of paints early on. I've restocked in the coming years, but this is a great brand, and you can get a set that's not much bigger or smaller than this, and it'll go a long ways once you mix the colors. The more colors you have, the better, just because you can get all the shades and variations that you desire, but this amount will get you pretty far. And this brand is Winsor & Newton, which is a great brand. I'm sure they have good brushes too. I don't remember what brand of brush this is. I think I just got it off of Blick. Blick is a great resource for relatively affordable art supplies. They have ranges too, so you can go from spending a small amount to a large amount, kind of up to you and your price range. But yeah, once you invest in watercolor, the paint lasts super long. I guess I keep thinking of things I would add that I like more about watercolor than acrylic, but that is one thing, is that you don't have to rebuy your paints often in comparison to acrylic. I mean, you push it out of the tube and it's gone. Like, if you waste any, you waste any. With the watercolor, you're never going to waste paint, because even if it dries up, you just have water. So that's a great benefit to the medium, I think. And you get to collect a bunch of little bottles. So I hoard like any bottles that I can find, because you want to designate a bottle or a jar to each color that you have and each shade. It's just easier to get it out. And so it's kind of fun to like arrange all your little cups and such. I think so, at least if you like keeping cool little bottles, you'll find my sentiment. So I can see that this is slowly drying. I think still a bit damp to the touch. And I might test it out just a bit since we have limited amount of time, but if you do choose to test out one that you're planning on keeping, then if you're testing out the bleed, I would test somewhere in the middle so that it doesn't edge up against your lines too much. So I'm just gonna slowly test out how dry this is. And it looks pretty dry to me right now, because it's not bleeding much upon touch, but instantly. But as it gets dry, the color kind of expands into the next, which makes sense, being called a bleed. But I think I'll go ahead and apply this just for the sake of time, and then reapply another crisper layer later and blend them out. So I'm using a somewhat dark blue, and I'm using a pretty small brush right now. This. and I'm applying darker shades, lighter shades. It's fairly easy to get a good variation with watercolor. And if you have too much paint on your brush and you need it to be lightened up, you can just add water. You always keep a paper towel near me, just kind of, if your brush is too full, to wipe it off and whatnot, to dry your brushes. So I've got just a small layer of light blue on there. It's actually a darker shade, actually, but I'm applying it thinly. And I'm just following the rough outline that I made for myself prior. So this is a good kind of background setting to go in and put more detailed, crisper lines. And you always want to start with the larger general areas and then work your way into smaller, more detailed parts. What we're doing here. So this is kind of like the little leaves or something that's growing on the bottom of this plant that I'm imagining. It's gonna be a crazy looking plant. All right, so I think I'll go ahead and do the general like greenish, but I'll make sure to keep a clear distance from the separation of the blue. And I have a green that's pretty light. Again, light to dark is important with watercolor. So I'm just still packing the brush full, and we're up to kind of a medium-sized brush for this size of paper. And I'm just gonna apply some light green over this leafy part. And I'm careful not to get it too close to the blue because the blue is also still wet. And I'm not too worried about keeping it exactly together with the lines. That makes sense. It's not too specific yet. If you're someone that worries about getting things like exactly as you have envisioned in your head or like a picture or something, it always helps to sketch it out previously on just a sketchbook. And then of course, sketch it on the paper. I've never just gone into a painting without a rough outline on it before. If you're feeling adventurous, maybe that would be. And I think for this top little antenna things, I'm gonna make those orange. I don't have any orange paint yet in a designated thing, so I'm gonna get just a bit out. And you don't want too much watercolor. These tubes look tiny, but they go a long ways. A set of these might last me a year, and I do like 20 to 30 paintings a year with fairly heavy coats. Honestly, they might last longer than a year. I've had these for a while. Then, so I have a very small amount of paint on there. It helps to have a little bottle to dump the color into. It's just easier than trying to dump a cup of it and getting it everywhere. Right. So I've added a decent amount of water here. This is just the lid of a jar, actually. And consistently make sure it's mixed up. You always want your paint consistency to be relatively watered down, just because that way It'll give the watercolor looking effect. If you go too thickly, it doesn't look like watercolor, and that's not the desired result. So before painting, you'll test it out on your trusty little book or pad. And that is very light, almost too light to see. You can't see that, but it's very thin. So I'm gonna add just a bit more of the orange. And it's always better to start with it being too light if you have a limited amount of container space, which eventually you will if you add enough water. So always better to start with less and go to more. So I'll add just a bit more. Again, not too much at all. And then mix it up. If you really want to be crazy, you can mix it up over the paper itself. And it's a little bit thicker. And I'm not sure that you can see from that distance, but the background is wet and it has caused a bleed. But since I applied it so thinly, it's bleeding in not too obvious ways. So that's nice. And so, like I said, I think I'll do this part up here in an orange. And I've tested it. I like the consistency it's at. Just lightly and generally applying the orange up here. And it's important not to leave any puddles anywhere that you don't want it to be a darker shade. I'm kind of leaving the excess at the top of the painting so that it dries with a gradient there. All right. Then we'll wait on it to dry. Rinse my brush out. Does anyone have any questions while we're waiting on it to dry again? Oops. Yeah, so you can use a dryer, like a hair dryer. It can't be dried too fast, which is what I was saying earlier about if it dries quickly, then it just doesn't typically dry as evenly with a hair dryer since it's such a small amount of heat going to a specific place. I think for it to dry evenly with a dryer, you'd have to have like the entire thing being dried consistently. Yeah, there might be something you could like put under it to dry faster. I've never tried that. There is a little bit of excess water over here from the paint. I'm just gonna clean up. Hope to dry a little bit faster. And I think it's dry. And you can see the driest part at the top. And because none of it's applied too thickly, you can pick it up at this stage. If I had more water on other areas, then you would obviously not want to be picking it up. But it's drying from the top to the bottom down. And this is our general area, little coverage. And the two wet-ish colors on top of each other are creating these bleeds, which kind of like at this stage, you can always, you know, let it dry and come back in crisper as long as it's not too dark. Always remember to work light to dark with watercolor. That's the most important. And so now I'm going to come back in down here around the blue area and going to add a bit of this sort of green aqua color. And I'm mixing this up well again because I haven't used this paint in about a week, so it's dried out a bit. Also, some watercolors have a weird kind of smell sometimes. I don't know if it's like because of the water being in it or what, but it's just something to be aware of, I guess. All right. There's a few little chunks in here that I'm just kind of smoothing out to make sure I don't get it onto the page. And so again, always testing out the color that you have. Ooh, that's quite dark. But since I have my reference color from previously, you can also do whatever color you're doing next over it to see how they'll look combined if you haven't made like a cheat sheet of shades and colors already. So this is quite dark. I don't want to be going in that dark yet. Light to dark is crucial to remember. So I'm gonna see if I have another color that's lighter. And if this isn't any lighter, you could always just add water to whatever concentrated color it is that you're trying to make lighter. This looks lighter, but it's not the exact shade that I'm going for, mainly because it's too close to the yellow that's already in the middle. Yeah, very similar to that. So I think I'm going to combine this color and the darker color to make a bit lighter in one of the little cups that I have. Always having spare cups is great just in case you run into the situation that I'm in right now where you don't like the shades that you have. You can just mix up a new one. So a bit of the first one and the other darker one, and I'm leaving enough room to add water, mixing it up well. And yeah, I like this shade much better. I'm looking at it right now, but I'm gonna give it a try on the paper just to make sure. Yeah, I think that's a good in between. It's not too dark, not too light. This one here is the shade. This was the previous one. This was the one I was just kind of unsure about. And in the background is just a little design I was practicing on earlier. But you'd want to leave like enough space from your base layers to check and see what your next colors are going to look like on top of that. So like this is what that would look like on the white versus on that, which is when you're getting down to color matching or you just have a really specific color that you're wanting to achieve, it's very important to test it out first. And down here looks relatively dry. Typically, if I were doing this myself, just alone, I would be waiting for it to dry fully and making sure that each layer is specifically dried. But like I said, since we're on a time sort of deal, I'm just gonna go ahead in. And this seems relatively dry, but like I said, it will seem that way at first. And then if it's even a bit moist, it'll start to bleed later on when it seeps in more. And I'm thinking of this as kind of like a mystical plant, so green for nature. And this is the part where I usually get kind of hyper-focused into what I'm doing, because you want it to spread out and be moved across the paper relatively quickly so that no spots dry unevenly. So it really does require your full focus to keep the color moving, especially if you're working in a concentrated area, which I am right now. And I'm making sure to move my brush quickly from one area to the next so that it's getting spread about evenly. And now I've pulled most of the paint from up here around to here and spread it as evenly as I can, only leaving puddles in corner areas or at the top of something so that it creates a gradient. And at this stage too, you can kind of mix in with whatever base color you had. So I'm just blending that out a bit right now. So we have one little leaf in 40 minutes, but its watercolor is very time consuming. The drying process is also very time consuming. Again, I'm just carrying my paint all the way out and I'm not letting it dry too quickly. It's blending in right now with the base blue that I put down in that general area, simply because the blue is not dry. And you can tell the difference in the dryness by the color. This one here is much lighter because it didn't blend as much with the blue. This one's darker because it blended more since it was wetter. So knowing what dryness your paper is, it's always crucial if you're working, trying to work quickly in watercolor. Watercolor kind of demands your patience in a lot of ways because of how tedious the drying process is. But like I said, I kind of enjoy that. It lets you feel not so pressured to finish it all in one sitting. You have to do it in typically multiple stages and times. Which if you have a busy schedule like I tend to, then that's preferable. And if I'm doing a more abstract piece, it's really fun to like put a splash of water down, watered paint, and just leave it alone and come back later and see how it's bled onto the page. And that can be really fun. And then if you're doing that with light colors, you can always come back and add crisper lines and whatnot with your darker colors that go on top. And so this is about layer two of however many layers you want to do to get as detailed as possible. But also once you've gone to a darker color, you can't go back to a lighter color, which is why the liquid masking fluid is so vital to having lighter, like fully white spots in your painting. Here we go. That on there, and this is a bit uneven right now, so I'm just going to smooth it out. And as long as it's still quite wet, you can move your brush along it fine without it causing any brush marks or uneven places. I'm just kind of moving the water around right now to get the most concentrated amount of water near the bottom, because that's where I would like it to be darkest, to make somewhat of a shadow type thing. Great. This yellow has really bled into the background color and it's kind of made a cool effect that I like. Also, if you have a watermark that you don't like and it's a light color, you can come in with water and you can just go over it and smooth it out That's not a bit of green. Wash my brush over. Different brush. And it's important, again, to have multiple waters so that you're not getting any previous colors mixed like I just did. But this is still a light enough stage that you can simply brush it out. If you are interested in getting cool watermarks though, there's a technique that's, it can be gimmicky if it's overused, but if you use it in just enough moderation, it's good. And that is to, when the paint is still fairly wet, like you just applied it, to just sprinkle salt on there, and that will create kind of like a burst of water, that kind of look. So if that is a technique you're going for or a style, then that's something. People sometimes overuse it and it just doesn't look quite as good, I think, but it's kind of fun, especially if you have like younger kids you're teaching watercolor to, keep them entertained and if they're tired of waiting on it to dry. So, and that, of course, the water bleeds and marks, they expand as it dries. That's something to be conscious of. So since this was early enough in, I was able to just smooth out this water line that was made here. Like I said, I kind of like what it looked like, but just for the sake of an example, it's nice and smooth it out now. You can see where it's gone. It looks lighter, but that's just because it's wet. And I think I'll go ahead and rub off the liquid masking tape just so you can see how well it works, because this here is mostly dry. And you just simply, with your finger, rub it off. My fingertips are totally like burnt from pottery. The winter is the worst. You can rub it or peel it. I think I should peel this instead. But yeah, it just comes. So now that I've got a piece of this, I'll show you. So right here, it's came up and you just pull it off, which is kind of weird because you don't expect it to just like peel off into like a little rubber piece. But it does, and you just brush it off. And then you have perfectly white paper underneath that you preserved from earlier. So highly recommend liquid masking tape. It's so nice. So here's how that looks. And from here, it's basically all about layering now. This wasn't entirely dry, so it did bit. Once you have it peeled up a bit, you can just grab onto it and pull it off. If you have fingernails. I also have very short fingernails from pottery. But here we go. This is great if you're doing lettering or something similar to lettering. You need it to stand out. And these green leaves that are coming up through here, I think I will use this darker green that I had previously. And just cover the general area again. Anyone have any other questions? And my brush is turning a little bit dry there, so I'll just add some more. And I'm starting to follow the lines a bit more for this layer. And the more layers you do, the more you might want to refer back to your light pencil lines. Always a good guide. We're getting, I have about 10 minutes. If you guys are interested in seeing any of my other work, acrylic paintings and pottery included, my Instagram is Sav, SavijJacob, Savvy J Jacob. And you can check out all my stuff there. That's where I post the most frequently. I also have an art Facebook page called Sav J Art, which is the name I go by for art related things. And I post a few like things for sale and whatnot there sometimes. Also do a ton of local festivals. Just did First Friday last night at the Murphy Center. Super fun, great environment there. I've gone there for a few First Fridays and had a booth, and it's always amazing. So highly recommend. I'm going to add on to the orange up here, which is a very faint orange right now. I'm mixing the water out of my brush, or the paint out of my brush. And since the orange is a bit smaller of an area, I'm going to transition to a smaller size brush in comparison to the one that I was using, which is this one. And I think I want to stick with the orange shade that I have, but just add some dimension and layers. So I'm going to add another layer of orange to make it darker, just where the shadows would fall. Same orange as before. Very lightly, just adding orange. Second layer. And this is still very thin. If I was waiting for this to dry entirely, I would have to wait probably like 15 to 20 minutes. It's kind of best to have one watercolor going and then a few others at the same time if you're planning on working like all day or something, so you're not just sitting around waiting. But then that starts the habit of creating a bunch of projects at once, which can be overwhelming. So choose your battles, I guess. Watercolor is demanding. All right. And again, some brushes in between. We have just a few minutes. Are there any last questions about the process, the materials, my practices, my preferences, anything like that, I'd be happy to answer. And yeah, from here, I'll just be letting it dry more, and I kind of like where it's going, so I think I'll let it fully dry out after this, and add just some detail, maybe some darker line work over the top. I kind of want it to be illustration-like. Like I said, I am an illustrator, so having the outlines over the top is really appealing to me with the lighter background. I know some people don't consider that to be like the professional watercolor if you like outline a marker or something over the top, but it's all about creative preference, so at least for me. And if you're not too like particular about technicalities and whatnot, you can disregard. But yeah, I think I'm gonna put just one more layer in the few minutes that we have over in this area where the blooms will kind of be coming out. And I'd like to use just a nice yellow and let's see what this is. I have a kind of a goldish color here. Sometimes when your paint's dry, they can get a weird like texture and just somewhat of low quality. Paints will do that. These are fairly nice paints, but even some of them, you know, they'll dry out a bit uneven and splotchy. And you just have to mix it a little longer to make sure you don't get any surprise bits of paint. I'm not sure why, but the yellow and a lot of different paints I've noticed has been kind of more particle-y or has more in it. It must be whatever they have to use to make it. So this yellow is very similar color to other vibe that I've been creating with these shades and tones and everything. So I kind of like it. And that's kind of my general color palette anyways, which is why I already have these shades and stuff. So eventually you develop like preferences and that leads to style. Most people do at least. And I'm just gonna apply these in the general areas over here while being conscious of the two white parts that I took the masking fluid off of. Which this is a good example of why the masking fluid is nice, because then you don't have to outline each part with your brush, which outlining is fine. It's just a little bit more time consuming, and you can avoid it if you want it to be fully white, or you can, you know, take off the masking fluid at one layer and then have another thin layer over it. It doesn't have to be entirely white, of course. Sometimes I end up making it like stark white because I like the deep contrast that you see at the end. So if this were my own piece, I would probably like get, you know, through a few layers and then I'd let it dry, work on another piece, let that dry, then come back to this one when it's dry and the other one's drying, and so on and so forth. Yeah, now we have a general goldish color there, making up what the blooms would be. Any more questions at all? Hopefully there's not any I've missed. Like I said, I haven't used Zoom in quite a while. What stops the color from bleeding under the mask area? Doesn't it soak through the paper there too? It actually doesn't. I don't know the full science of the liquid masking tape, but it's kind of adheres to it like you would imagine rubber or something too, and it just, the color doesn't bleed into it. Not totally sure why. Yeah, you're surprised. Yeah. Yeah, so I think if that's all the questions and everything.
Savannah, thank you so much. This is Jason. I work with Les. Actually, I'm her husband, but I work with Fisher's Arts Council. So thank you so much. I appreciate your time. This is gorgeous.
Thank you.
Do you tend to stick to more organic shapes and organic figures and things when you do watercolor? Do you find yourself more in that space? Do you see people doing more hard lines or abstract stuff?
I kind of go in between. I'll show you the other watercolor I'm working on right now, and it's much crisper lines.
Oh yeah.
Which is just more tedious and. In that respect, the drying process becomes very crucial because if you overlap one small color, it'll bleed. So I go back and forth from super organic like this, where there's a bunch of bleeds and like crazy shapes, to then really strict, harsh lines and houses. I live in an area that's being gentrified, and the contrast in houses next to each other has really been just like amazing to me lately. So I've been painting houses side by side, and it's a much different process, but it's still really rewarding. So thanks for asking.
That's awesome. Well, let's see. Thank you so much for the demonstration today. I know we're like Les said, we're streaming out on Facebook and other places. Sorry for the dogs. But we're going to go ahead and transition over here. Thanks for this. We'll see you soon.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And let's see, Allison, if I can ask you to turn on your video.
All right, so we are getting ready for Allison to start her demonstration. She is going to work with alcohol ink, I believe on copper, and she'll be starting shortly. Hey, Allison, how are you? Oh, you're a little muted.
There we go. Hello.
Hello, Allison.
Hi.
We're going to demonstrate some work with jewelry and alcohol ink and copper, right?
Yes, and let me see if I can get my setup a little bit more where you can see what I'm doing.
All right, so Allison, we are on Zoom with Allison. So if you want to join her, you can come to fishersartscouncil.org/winterwonderland and you can interact directly. You can also just keep watching us on our YouTube live stream, on our website, or on Facebook. So Allison, you are the person of the hour. I'm going to let you take it away.
Hi, my name is Allison Kruer, and I work with copper and silver. And tonight I'm going to show you how to work with alcohol ink and copper. And so I have a few pieces of copper, and some I went ahead and put some texture on and just to kind of get a variety. And then also just some plain pieces. Here, I'll go ahead and move this so that you can see what I'm working on. And I don't see if you can tell. These pieces here have some texture. This one here is plain. And just a few odds and ends. This one, I have stars. I had actually started working on them earlier and never really quite finished. So I thought, well, you know what? It's a perfect time to finish it up. So just a few little pieces, different shapes, different sizes. And also I have some wood disc. So I kind of wanted to kind of play around on some different pieces. So, just to kind of get a different effect, but let's pull these aside and just to kind of start with, here's the textured pieces and this is just plain, just so that you can kind of see what is the difference. And what we do is you can also, what we get started with is just your regular alcohol that you get from the grocery store. It's just 91% rubbing alcohol. And I picked up my set from Hobby Lobby. And it's alcohol ink. And granted, I'm not affiliated with Hobby Lobby. It's just a great store. And it's an alcohol ink. Actually says alcohol ink on it. And you can get felt and then cut it into squares. And I also use great to have the cosmetic round cotton round applicators. Q-tips are great. I also have napkins and whatnot. You can wear gloves if you like. I prefer to just to get messy. Roll up your sleeves. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to get some rubbing alcohol and we're going to clean our pieces. So I'm just going to take a square, put some rubbing alcohol on this, my applicator here, and start rubbing on our disc, our copper disc, front and back. And that is to just get the, and then we're not going to touch it much, just to get the dirt off, dirt and oil from our fingers, get that off. So we're just going to clean it a bit. And I like to use a paper plate, just so that I use them off and on, just and the ink will dry and then I can reuse it. So I'll use it over and over and over again. So I just do the fronts and backs. And then, so I rub it front and back. And then I can go over to the edge and kind of flip them over. So I'm keeping the textured ones up here, the plain, non-textured ones, I should say, down here. So I don't know if you can tell from how, if it's showing up very well on the screen. So we'll do that. I'll set this off to the side. Let me shut that. Okay, so what we'll do is, let me set this back over here. So our first thing is, here's our, we'll take some colors. We'll just kind of shake them up. And our applicator, felt applicator, it has, we call it a Velcro on the end of the stamp. And so it'll fit really nice on there. And so we can, after you shake it up, well, we can open it up and just add a few little dots on here, just kind of around random, just randomly. And we'll do another. We'll do another color. And sometimes I can just put a dot of color on here as well. I do that occasionally too. And if you're not into matchy-matchy, that is perfectly great too. This is metallic. We'll hold off on the metallic just because I'll usually put that over a color. This one's an orange. So we're going to have teal and orange. So we'll shake it up. As you see, I'm kind of liberal with it. It's already got some on the piece and we'll just kind of dab it on there. And of course the orange really is kind of hard to see on the copper anyway, but we'll just kind of dab it. And we'll dab down here too on the non-textured pieces too. And let's put a cap on that too. And then we'll set that off to the side so we don't get that. We can use a hair dryer to dry it faster. Put it on low. And then we can add another color. And then what we can do, we can go ahead and let's see, let's kind of start playing with some color. Let's dip a Q-tip in alcohol and let's kind of dab it on here. Kind of get it to Okay, I set that off to the side. And then let's shake up our metallic really good. Then I'm just gonna actually dab it on here directly. Just a couple. And you can even see it kind of interact with the alcohol. And let's take our hair dryer before it dries, and you can kind of blow it around. Even let's do a little higher. Too much, or we can get him to move a little bit. We can actually get him to drip a little. And if you're not seeing the reaction you're wanting, let's dip our paintbrush in here that's clean. And we can even get him to splatter, and he'll start to do a little bit of movement. Well, come back here. Move him with your nail. And you can move him around a little bit. Put him right there. And let's see what other color we want to play with. Let's do some red. Let's see, where's my little, oh, it's right here. And let's add some blending. And I'll just add that on there too. And it actually, you can even see it kind of interact with that as well on the felt. And we'll just kind of add a few drops. Just kind of around. And then we'll just kind of dab it on there. And we'll even put some on here that's so you just come up with different kinds, different colors, different reactions to each piece. So we'll dry it again. These two look very Christmassy. Add a little yellow. So you can layer, you can also add like stamps, you can do that as well. You can add as many colors as you would like, just different ones. So yeah, I mean, just different effects that you can make. You can also do it on glass. Is really, really pretty as well. I've got these paint brushes there. I went ahead and filled them up with alcohol, and then you can go in and kind of paint with them. to get different effects. And you can be very detailed or just go in and kind of be abstract. And then the brush just cleans itself. You can use a napkin or paper towel and it'll clean your brush. And then the alcohol will just eventually clean it and then you off to start again. And then you can add some blending color if you want. And let's say you want to add another color. This looks like it is teal. And so you can add it directly onto that. And then it kind of waters up. And you can go in with your alcohol pen and kind of make it do different effects around. And then also I've noticed in doing this that you can also get it to slide around and then it will also go up underneath your piece as well. And then that's really cool too, because it's just a look of the draw of what you get. And so that's really pretty cool. Whoops. And then of course that happens. But so it's really neat. This paintbrush, I should say, not pen, has a thinner brush. And so you can actually go in and make finer lines. So that's a neat little embellishment that you could do. We can go in and pick up the ink and bring it into this other piece. And make something like, I don't know, like little leaves or something, or pick up, bring in the color, since that has a lot right there. So that you're not wasting it per se. You can always bring in and bring in another piece and add to it. So it's just a really fun way to use color on copper. And then that'll dry really, really interesting too. And it'll just be a really, really neat effect. And then you're like, oh, I want to do that again. And you'll try to do it again as well. And you can do it on paper and things like that. These little round things too, I textured as well. And so it's just neat how it fills in with the texture. So it's just, and of course it's got alcohol in this as well. And so it's just cutting through there and just making a really neat texture. So let's see, this is a yellow. So we'll go ahead and we'll take this off, put on a new one. Well, let's try these. Let's do this. Do something a little different. We'll put color on his. On this side, and we'll use this blue. So we'll do blue and yellow. So we'll just dab it. And there again, you just layer on colors. And then we'll use our hair dryer. I'm gonna move that over there. So now that that's got a total shade of color, let's try this again. Maybe now you'll be able to see it better. So we'll splash. There we go. Yeah. So that's, now you can see the alcohol. It's coming through a little better. So I don't know if you can see that, but it's lightening up in areas. So it's got a better reaction to that. So you can actually do that over here as well. So it's just making it a little bit more of a, you can see the reaction to it. So, so you can do that. Let's see. So we can go back to layering some more colors. Let's do some more blue. Well, there again, we'll dab him and we'll layer more colors on him. So. So yeah, it'll get messy. That's for sure. I'm actually surprised I don't have alcohol or not alcohol, but ink all over me. I usually do. So, but that too is what makes it fun. So, anyway, so let's see, let's do some red. We'll go over here so I don't get any more. And then we'll add some more. I think this one's looking really pretty, these two. That one might need a little bit of yellow to kind of match. They may not be matchy-matchy, but I try to use the same colors so that they look like they at least go together. So you can also, you can also use a flame, but also be aware it is alcohol, so it is flammable. So you have to be aware that, don't be around anything that is combustible. So, take precautions. So just be careful. And that actually comes off looking like this. Like this is that regular alcohol ink on with texture. And then with a flame, it burns off the alcohol. So there again, you just have to be careful. Don't be inside. You know, you have to take precautions. That's something different to do. So let's dry these and let's see, because They've got ink, and I bet that's ink underneath as well. Let's see. And then we'll see what we look like underneath, because that's always something fun. Okay. The inks come in all different colors. So, you know, you can also, so that's kind of cool. You're going to add some colors to that as well. I'll flip them over, see what other fun things we can do. Like I said, I can be kind of messy. Here, we'll use that too. So I'll go over here. So we got blue and yellow on this one. And here. Sometimes on the backs, I do different colors. Just to kind of, for an unexpected fun, I'll do something a little different on the back. Let's see. On this, which one was this? This one. Let's do, this is the blending. Let's do that, and then let's do a stamp just for something so you can kind of see what that looks like. These are just rubber stamps, and the blending is just so that the stamp will stay. So let's just, and the green doesn't come off. So the black, you can kind of see, we'll just do it on a regular copper. There you go. So just something a little different. You could do just a regular kind of on a since it's, here I do on that side, a partial stamp. Do the blending on here. Kind of scooching. And then we'll do a partial. So it'll be on half of it. Well, he didn't really show up. He kind of did, but not a whole lot. Well, shoot. Let's see if he shows up on this one. Well, he's not one to show up. I don't think that stamp has a whole lot of depth like the flower did, wherever the flower went. Yeah. Yeah, he's carved out a lot more. Maybe that's what it is. So let's go ahead and finish. Let's see, that wasn't the right one. We'll go ahead and finish these little discs. Put some more blue. And put some more yellow. And let's dry him. I also, whenever I get finished, I spray them with lacquer. That also keeps the alcohol, or I'm sorry, not the alcohol, but the ink, safe from scratching. So I don't do that inside, but I do that step at the end. So let's see. So what I also do is, I'm going to make these into a pendant. So I have my little hole puncher. So let's go ahead and we'll punch a hole so that we can join these two. I'll make a pendant. That, and we'll do this one as well. The lacquer also makes them shiny. I mean, they're kind of shiny now, but it also gives them a pretty shine. Jump ring. Let's see. Since we textured these, let's make sure our texture is in the front. So. Oh, those are pretty cute. And we'll put a leather pull cord. And we'll just make that our, pull it through it that way. And then when we, I'll add the lacquer to it. And then that, of course, will protect that up there. Protect the leather piece up there. And I will also show you how to do a pull cord as well. So we'll bend this over, we'll say 4 inches. We'll just go ahead and bend it over, put this end in the middle. And then we'll take the middle around under, and then we'll go 3 times around. And then through your loop. And then we'll pull and scrunch. And then same thing. I don't think I did it long enough. You know what? I should have measured. I didn't. That was my fault. I just did a length and cut it off. So let's do that again. So let's untie this so I don't waste it. So we'll pull this out again. Set that aside. Okay. Yeah, I just pulled off a chunk and was like, oh, that's plenty. Okay. Let's do this again. Okay. So we'll loop it around. Yeah, and like I said, I'll lacquer it and it'll be nice and shiny and have that protective coating. The fumes are just so bad. I don't like to do it inside. Okay, so I've got plenty now for sure. Okay, so we'll loop it. Put the other end in the middle. We'll take the end around. Take it around 3 times. Go through the loop. My fingers aren't wanting to work. Pull and scrunch. So then we pull this in. Okay, we do the same thing. Move that around. That's when you pull down. Okay. And you can make your knots part of the design if you like. And of course you can cut off your extra. So, yeah, let's get that more in the middle. Not that I'm that particular, but it just looks better, I think. So there's our pendant, and it's on a pull cord. And then, like I said, I will apply the fixative on there, and that will protect the ink from scratching off and also give it a protective layer and also keep it shiny. So there's that. And then let's see, we can finish up our pieces here. Let's do our little stars. And here I'll show you like the wood disc. Oh, look, that's all kind of stuck. So there we go. Let's finish up them. So let's add some blue. Well, we did blue. Let's see. Let's do some orange. So on the wood, it'll soak it up and it'll go with the green. It's really pretty cool. And it'll kind of dull it. I still put lacquer on it just to give it a shine. So it's really pretty cool on the wood, just for something different. And let's do little drops. And I like the little texture that ended up coming through here. And it's just the fibers from here as well. And then you can actually go through and kind of dab at it as well. You can also take a marker and make designs that way. You can draw, you can just do different things that way with a marker. There again, let's see, what else do I have? Let's do this. The stars are domed, so the color will go towards the tips. So that's kind of interesting. So since we got ink on our brush, it'll kind of do interesting different effects. Let's see, I've got some gold. I'm gonna shake that. Clean off this brush, and the alcohol in it will clean it. Go in there and actually come in. It will bleed into and kind of marble and like in the blue. Take our Q-tip and kind of dab at it. Let's see, that's got. See here. We've got a little bit. There we go. Little splatters. They're looking really good. See, let's try that. Okay, let's add, let's see. Yeah, let's add a little bit of gold. Just a few little drops. I actually like the little fibers left over from like the cosmetic pads or the Q-tips. I like the fibers that are left over in there, that's left over in the copper and the ink and whatnot. I like that extra texture. That's a little extra. Little extra bonus. You can also add just a little off to the side. Because I'm like, this one has some blue and this one doesn't have a whole lot. I just kind of want to add a little blue. Not to be matchy-matchy, but I just kind of want the same colors so that you know that they are together, because I'm envisioning these as earrings. So I'm like, I just want them to be a pair. So yeah, after layer and layer and layers of colors. Let's dry it quick. And we'll make these earrings. So same thing, let's see, I'll punch a hole. Whoops, punch our holes. Normally I do our back, but I notice we're getting kind of close to our time.
ear wires. Okay. And we have our pretty earrings. Okay. So does anyone have any questions, or I notice we're kind of close to our time, so.
Are some metals easier to work with the ink and the alcohol than others? I mean, do you find that copper works better than other metals?
Well, actually, I do like working with copper the best. Silver is kind of expensive to work with, so I don't normally do work with the silver much, but I mostly just copper.
Copper is going to bring a little bit of the metal itself has a hue, right? So it's going to change things a bit.
Yes. Yeah. And then too, I do work with the silver or what have you, and you can actually bring that through as well. So it's nice to have that different color or what have you. So yeah, so like the copper will come through, like you said, has that own hue as well. So it's nice that it has its own color.
Well, that's fantastic. We really appreciate you doing this demo. Thank you so much. I guess one other question I was thinking of really quick, since we have a second, is what range of materials do you use? Like when you make the pendants, what range of materials do you use for the cording? I mean, is it mostly leather or cotton, or what are the different materials you might use?
It's mostly leather. I make the chain out of copper or silver. It's just kind of dependent. Today I just decided, well, I didn't know what the time would be. And so I thought, well, let's just do a pull cord and use some leather. So, so that's just what I decided to do. But normally I do copper chain or silver.
And then the last question I had was, when you apply the lacquer, I know you said you weren't going to do that because it's inside and you don't want to mess with the fumes. I totally get that.
Yeah.
Do you find that deepens the appearance of the ink? Like there was a previous artist that was talking about when they applied the clear coat, it really kind of brought a lot of contrast into the color and sort of made that deeper and richer. Do you find the same thing here?
I do. It does. I think it makes it brighter and it does help it last. And you know, cause it, when you wear it and whatnot, you don't want it to scratch or anything like that. So sure. It's just another benefit to it, that it does enhance the color.
That's fantastic. Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And this has gone out to on the Fishers Arts Council website, as well as the our YouTube channel, and also on our webpage. So we really appreciate the demonstration as part of Winter Wonderland. And thank you for showing us how you make all this amazing stuff. I know that I've seen a lot of this stuff, these things available around. And so hopefully, where can people go to find your products?
I'm on Etsy. You can go to Etsy. You can also contact me directly on Facebook or my Instagram page, which is Artsy Alley Creating Yourself. You can also do that as well.
Fantastic. All right. Thank you so much, and have a good evening. I think we're going to call it here, and appreciate everybody who was watching the streams as we had these three fabulous artists show us how they do what they do and create some of the magic that they create. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. Good night.